Public Affairs programming on WQPT is brought to you by the Sing Group at Merrill Lynch, serving the wealth management needs of clients in the region for over 25 years.
Are you ready to vote? In Iowa, you'll need to prove who you are. And Scott County wants to know what you think about trash in the cities. It's been a few years since Scott County residents started a new way to recycle. So would you give it a passing grade? A way for you to weigh in up next. But Tuesday is primary election day throughout Iowa, and you get to winnow the list of Democrats, Republicans, and Libertarians on the ballot for state and county offices. But you might need to be better prepared before you show up at the polls. Joining us is Scott County Auditor and Commissioner of Elections, Roxanna Moritz. How are you doing?
I'm doing great, thank you.
We did, of course, have a little bit of news last week in regards to a Democratic candidate for governor, and we've got Nate Bolton, who has suspended his campaign, but his name will remain on the ballot.
Correct. Once you've got your name on the ballot, it does not come off. And so for those people that may have already cast a vote for him,
that's the big question.
Obviously, that vote is going to still be cast for Mr. Bolton. So if you're sitting on a ballot at home, though, and you voted for Nate but have not mailed that ballot in, you can call my office and we will give you another ballot. So we can take that ballot out of the system and give you another one. So if you're still sitting on it and haven't mailed it, I haven't recorded it, you have the opportunity to now vote for a different person, so should you choose to.
But once it leaves your hand,
gone.
That's the end of it, isn't it?
That's it.
Okay, and it's not that unusual to have candidates on a ballot who has either suspended their election or even, God forbid, have died or other extreme circumstances.
Absolutely not. That's how I got on the ballot.
Is that so?
I replaced Karen Fitzsimmons, who had passed away.
Absolutely, that's
and
right.
And she was on the primary. And then I came through the process of being voted on through an election through committee, through the party affiliation, and got on the ballot in the general election. But yes, her name was on the ballot after she unfortunately passed away.
I had forgotten about that.
Yes.
That is right. We want you here mostly to talk about the new Iowa voter ID law enacted by the legislature. A lot of people may not understand exactly. It's being phased in. Not everything goes into effect this year, but some of the major ramifications of that legislation do take effect in the June primary.
They do. So it's the Iowa Voter Integrity Act. It was started to be phased in last year, but mostly it's this year, and then it will follow through into 19. There are a few things that people need to know when they go to the polls. One, they are going to be asked for an ID. So some people may challenge that, but they need to have an ID. If they don't have an ID, though, there are a few caveats this year that will allow them the same opportunity as in the past to be able to vote. One, they can have an attester, so someone from their precinct can come and say, yes, I know this person, I'm registered to vote, and we'll let them vote.
That person then signs for you, do they not?
That's
and
right.
Vouches for you officially.
That's
so you can't just
right.
drag someone in the street who you don't know.
No. The second is you can always do a provisional ballot no matter what. If you have any issues at a poll, then it goes to an absentee board who looks at that documentation once you bring it in. The easiest thing to do if you don't have...
Before you get to that, because I would like to point that out too, is the provisional ballot is also something that you may have voted, but then you still have to take that next step. You still have to prove who you are, which is what you were pointing out.
Right. But there's other reasons to do a provisional, like I might think I live in this precinct, but we're saying you don't. You're committed to voting there. They might do a provisional ballot. Then it'll go to a board. Right. But if you're saying you don't have ID, you can do a provisional ballot and then bring your ID down to my office and verify it, and we'll attach it to that ballot. The easiest way to do it this year, though, is if you really are who you say you are and you happen not to have a photo ID with you, is to sign an affidavit legally saying that that's who you are, knowing that if you are lying, that you know that's a felony and there's a $7,500 fine attached to that. So there's three ways that they can still vote without a photo ID this year.
We have talked in the past about the legitimacy of the elections throughout Iowa, throughout Scott County. We really don't have that many problems, do we?
I don't think we have problems in Scott County, the state, or nationally. There's been several national studies done that have showed that there is not voter impersonation. So is there an opportunity for fraud? There has been, and that depends on how you depict that. So we had a woman in Des Moines who voted twice in the last presidential year.
Right.
She said Trump told her vote didn't count, so she voted twice. That's against the law. But I don't believe that we ever have any known cases of voter impersonation. So I think that was what the photo ID is for, is voter impersonation. Sometimes people will perhaps vote twice if they're in a nursing care facility, maybe not realizing they already voted once. If that happens, though, we're a paper ballot system. We go in and take one out, their first one counts. We had a 96-year-old man in the presidential election. My hospital team voted him one that day. His son came and took him to the early voting site and voted him the same day twice, one day. He just didn't know that he'd vote.
And like we're saying, that's not widespread in a way.
Right, that is not
fraud. But that's different than, I think some people get confused, that's different than being on a number of voter rolls. If you lived in one state and you moved to another state and that you're still registered in both states,
right.
That's not necessarily fraud either. That's just, you left.
No, we have lots of people, and especially because you know we're a border state, my numbers change constantly because people come to Illinois, they come to Iowa, we do the back and forth. We know that for businesses, for school, lots of reasons. So yes, just because you're on a voter roll in Illinois and you vote in Iowa does not mean you voted twice. You're just on two rolls. And that happens a lot in a lot of places, because unless you notify your commissioner of elections, you stay on the voter roll until you have not voted in two general cycles, which is 8 years.
And that's when you get cleaned off the roll, so to speak. You get scrubbed at that point.
There's a process of removing someone's name, and we just can't arbitrarily go in and take people's names off, nor would you want us to.
A little earlier, you said that when you do show up at the poll, you do need a form of ID. There are about, what, six different forms of ID. You don't necessarily have to have a driver's license.
Nope, there are six forms. You can have a driver's license with a photo. You can, and it does not have to be an Iowa driver's license. It just has to be a driver's license that's not expired. And then you can show proof of residency, because we're a same-day registration state. You can have a state ID that has a photo on it. You can have a military card. You can have a passport. Or you can have a college ID of some sort. As long as it has an expiration date and a photo, we'll take it.
Okay, that's understood. But it also has an implication and ramification as far as absentee ballots and early voting as well,
yes,
does it not?
It does.
And we're running down to the last few days. You can do that anyhow.
Yes. So what happened in the change in the law with this new voter integrity law was that you no longer could use your Social Security number. You can only use on an absentee request form. The only two things you can use is one is your driver's license number or a PIN number. A PIN number comes from the Secretary of State's office, and that is something that they identified as a state. About 180,000 people in this state don't have either a driver's license or a state ID. So for those people, the state sent out a PIN number that they will use when they ask for an absentee or when they go to the polls and they don't have an ID.
Is there now a shorter period of time as far as absentee ballots are concerned? Because that seemed to have been another change that was coming our way.
There is. And so that went from, we have UOCAVA voters, which are 45 days out. Those are people that are overseas, military, and or living out of the country. And then it used to be you could vote 40 days before an election. That's now down to 29 days before an election. So it did shorten the period of time, 10 days on the front and on the back end. And the concern for our office is, yesterday I got 15 request forms that I can't send ballots out to. It used to be you could request a ballot up till the Friday before an election. So I have these applications that I now must by law call and or send a letter to telling them that I cannot send them a ballot.
Now, all of this is supposed to make our elections a little more, I don't know, is it transparent, safer, cleaner? Lawmakers approve that. I don't think a lot of auditors were all that happy about that.
No, and the first time that it came through, I believe out of 99 counties, 97 counties were opposed to photo ID. And the reason is because we know our systems. We know what we do in the checks and balances. But I absolutely do understand from the community side, them saying they want photo ID for the integrity of the elections because they don't see what we see. I'm not a supporter, but they don't see what we see.
Sure.
And so I think that you're saying you don't have faith in our system when you say we need a photo ID. A voter registration card for me would be perfect. Show me your voter registration card. We've identified you through DOT. We've identified your social security number. We've identified you. We know where you live. Your voter registration card right now really means nothing.
Is that so?
Got to have a photo ID.
Photo ID is all that
your
you
need. Your voter registration card means nothing. That being said, don't throw it away. Mm-hmm. It tells you where to vote. It tells you your polling location. It tells you which elections you vote where. So it is important to you personally. It just doesn't have any validation at the polls.
Let's talk about this upcoming June primary. It's an important election. We're you know, you got governor's races that are going to decide who the nominee is for each party. I mean, it's an important race, but yet, as you were pointing out, it is June. It's summer. It's a time when people aren't around. Is this a tough time to have a primary?
Very tough. People just are not in the mode of thinking about elections. And you have to remember, in a primary, the money is not spent. So mm-hmm. in a general election, you are bombarded with phone calls. You're bombarded with the media, commercials, ads. People aren't thinking ever in June about voting in a primary. I think the highest in the last 20 years statistically that we saw was 12.6% in 2006.
Wow.
So we're hoping people will come out and vote, but I'm going to say 7 to 10%.
And you're always looking, especially during the primaries, for poll workers. I mean, that's not something that, can they still try to get involved for this election? It's a little
too late. Oh, absolutely. I have training.
Is that so?
I have training all day tomorrow, which your show won't air by then. But and I have training all day Saturday. Mm-hmm. And if someone wants to work and we're short, we'll just plug them in to make sure that we have balance, because we want to make sure that each polling location we have Republicans and Democrats mm-hmm. to make sure that there's equity and balance. So if someone wants to get involved, we're more than willing to take them.
Scott County Auditor Roxanna Moritz, who is also Commissioner of Elections, thank you so much for joining us. Big changes, and people just have to be up on it. And if they go to your website, you do have a video there, and it pretty well explains everything.
And I have to give kudos to the auditor who did it. Was the Johnson County
Notice
auditor,
that, yep.
Travis Weipert. He did a great job with his local media stations doing that video.
All right, thank you, Mark.
Thank you.
Still ahead, do you like Scott County's recycling program? Why trash should be on your mind in the coming days. But first, getting ready to see some of those summer activities and see them move into full swing. Here's Laura Adams. She's out and about.
This is Out and About from May 28th through June 3rd. Hi, I'm Laura Adams. The Quad Cities is hosting Memorial Day services at Summit Church and the Milan American Legion, while the Village of East Davenport is the place to be for the Quick Star Criterium, bike racing at its fastest. Or enjoy the One Tough Cookie 5K Fun Mud Run and Obstacle Course at Camp Conestoga in New Liberty June 2nd. Or in Andover, it's the More Fun on 81. It's the festival at Andover Lake Park on June 2nd and 3rd. It's time to get your tickets to Bettendorf Rotary's 12th Annual Lobster Fest, while the Norma Leah Ovarian Cancer Initiative turns modern Woodman Park teal on June 1st with Strikeout Ovarian Cancer Night. Or sample the hundreds of different ways to fix rhubarb during Alito's Rhubarb Festival June 1 and 2. Moline Center Thursday Night Summer Concert Series at Bass Street Landing kicks off May 31st with Smooth Groove. The 7th Annual Laura's Legacy for ALS is happening at Schwebert Riverfront Park June 2nd, and the glorious music of the Bridges of Madison County is on stage at Circa 21 Dinner Playhouse. Timberlake Playhouse presents Reba and Friends, which opens their 2018 concert series on May 25th at the Mount Carroll Theater. NQC Theater Workshop presents the hilarious musical comedy Reefer Madness. For more information, visit WQPT.org.
Thank you, Laura. Jason Carl is a Davenport singer and songwriter who blends rock and folk music into his original recordings. Team him up with Ben Lawrenson, Steve Lauder, Jamie Hopkins, and Serena Whitmer, and you've got Jason Carl and the whole damn band, as they're called. But we caught up with him as a solo performer at Moline's Black Box Theater. Here's Jason Carl with Hearts and Faces.
In the bitter cold, I thought of you. Out in Colorado, living it up. I've known so long what I've never been able to say. And and I'm holding my breath cause I believe in you. But I wouldn't say it if it weren't the truth. I know it's hard leaving, but that's the price you pay. When I add up what I've laid to waste, the world can be a depressing place. And I don't know if it's really round, I just know it can't bring me down. Cause it's only time and places, and I've been sick of this place for a long time. I recognize all the faces on the street, and it's only hearts and faces. And my head gets in the way of my heart sometimes. I don't recognize the places in my dreams. But it's only hearts and faces and the spaces in between. The second time I noticed you, I wish I could say I knew what to say, but I don't get approached by many girls like you. And looking back through those yesterdays, well, I don't regret a single thing. Well, that's a lie, but at least this much is true. When I add up what I've laid to waste, the world can be a depressing place. And I don't know what's coming around, I just know it can't bring me down. Cause there's only time and places, and I've been sick of this place for a long time. I recognize all the faces on the street, and they're only hearts and faces. And my head gets in the way of my heart sometimes. I don't recognize the places in my dreams. But it's only hearts and faces and the spaces in between.
Jason Carl with Hearts and Faces. It's been 5 years since the folks who pick up the trash in Scott County asked you what you think of their service. But there's been a lot that has changed since 2013, especially when it comes to recycling. And now those same folks want to revisit the topic and find out what you think now about trash and recycling pickup. And joining us is the director of the Scott County Solid Waste Commission, Kathy Morris. Thanks so much for joining us.
Sure.
Well, let's talk about what's happened since 2013. That was the last time you did a survey. First off, just real quickly, what did you find out 5 years ago?
We found out that our residents wanted recycling to be easier. They wanted to know what to recycle, when they wanted to recycle it. They didn't want to have to read a garbage guide to find out that information. And then we found out that maybe we needed to do a little more maintenance education. A lot of our 18 to 34 year olds didn't even know that you weren't supposed to put yard waste in the trash can. So it was just kind of a wake up call for us, and convenience was the major theme.
And there goes Go All In program, which started, I want to say, 3 years ago. Is it less than three?
Less than three. It was actually August 1st of 2016.
And that really has changed a lot of how Scott County picks up its trash.
It has been amazing. It not only formed new partnerships with some of the Illinois Quad City members and some of our outlying communities like Clinton, but it also encouraged Scott County residents to recycle more.
Absolutely. Now, I should point out, the Go All In is basically the blue carts. It's the recycling portion of the Scott County Solid Waste Management. So tell me, how important has recycling been to the life of the landfill? And people may not realize this. Landfills have only a certain period of time they're allowed to exist.
That's correct. And so what we try to do is put the minimal amount of garbage that we can into our landfill and keep as much material out as possible. The Go All In program has actually got Davenport and Bettendorf residents recycling over 60% more than they did prior to our single stream program. So that's just been an amazing turnaround.
So why did it take so long for it to go into effect?
Well, single stream recycling is a difficult undertaking.
It is.
We were only recycling about 7,000 tons per year during our dual stream program. And without additional tonnage, we couldn't even contemplate single stream. So we looked for partners, and our partners in Illinois assisted. Midland Davis committed to bring the recycling that they collected in the Illinois communities over to Scott County. That gave us the tonnage that we needed to build that facility. When we opened, we were counting on 14,500 tons that first year. And as of this past month, we're recycling about 30,000 tons per year.
That is a big difference, isn't
it?
So I think, I'm not quite sure. Recycling obviously keeps it out of the landfill, but there seems to have been less of a market for some forms of recycling. I mean, remember when people were always collecting newspapers, and it was like, oh no, that's been kind of oversaturated. Is there still a big market for all these types of recycling?
There's still a market, but recently China has caused an impact to our recycling here in the United States. Approximately 40% of the mixed paper that was collected actually goes to China, mostly from the East and West Coast. China has put restrictions on that, and because of that, there's a lot more mixed paper here in the United States looking for markets. We're very fortunate. Our residents do a tremendous job with the quality of their material, so we've been able to market our material, but the value of that mixed paper has dropped substantially. We're talking about from August of last year, where it was about $75 a ton, down to about $2.50 a ton.
Well, that's a huge difference.
Exactly.
Well, you know, I can't move off of recycling until I give you two words: pizza boxes.
Absolutely. Probably one of our biggest questions.
I would think so.
Clean pizza boxes are okay. If there's a little bit of grease on it, it's okay. If it's saturated with grease, it needs to go in the trash. But otherwise, it can go into the go-all-in bin.
Yeah, but almost all pizza boxes have some grease. I mean, you've got a typical pizza here.
Mm-hmm.
Do you throw that away, or do you recycle that?
Again, it depends. If you've got a lot, if it is saturated and you see a lot of grease on the box, then you should throw it away or tear the top off and recycle that.
Mm-hmm.
But if it's a spot or two, then you can go and put it in your bin. No crusts.
That's good to know. Also talk about another form of recycling, that is electronics, and you guys have been very successful in actually taking them apart, and also a form of resale. I didn't even know that you sold some of the equipment that you do get.
Yes, probably the most important thing to know about our electronics program is that we are R2 certified. That's responsible recycling, and that also includes being ISO 14001 certified and OSHA's 18001 certified. Those certifications are important because our residents and businesses can know that their data will be protected and that we are going to do the right things with the hazardous components that are found in those electronics. Our recycling facility is just one of the models for a public facility. In fact, I think it's the only public facility that has those certifications worldwide. We take the material in, we wipe or shred the data, and then we evaluate the items for reuse purposes. We test all key functions, and when it's reusable and we can sell it, we actually have an eBay site that you can find from our website. Go to facilities and electronic demanufacturing facility, and you'll see the eBay link there. And that's been very successful. Our staff is doing a wonderful job recycling computers, audiovisual items, there's all kinds of things that you can buy on that site.
So we've talked about all the changes that have happened in the last 5 years, and now you kind of want to have that report card, don't you? Tell me a little bit about this survey and what you hope to learn from it.
Well, we made recycling a lot easier.
Mm-hmm.
We followed best practices from the recycling partnership. So I don't know if you remember, but you had to look at those numbers on the bottom of the containers.
Always did, absolutely.
Yep. Now you can literally just recycle plastic bottles and jugs. So less rules, less restrictions. Just look at the picture on the top of the cart and put what's in the put in the cart what's in the picture. Mm-hmm. And that's pretty safe and pretty easy. That's been easier. From our household hazardous material program, we eliminated the need for appointments. And our residents have responded very well to that.
That's been a big deal as well. But about the survey, are people going to be calling? How is that going to work out?
Yes, we are calling, and it's a relatively short survey. We just want to know, how are we doing? Are you happier with the service? Are there things you'd still like us to do? How do you feel about food waste diversion? That's another thing that we might be asking. So just checking to make sure we're doing the best job possible.
Because like you said, every shred you can keep out of the landfill makes the landfill last longer, and that's so critically important.
Absolutely. One of my first tasks in this position was to go through a landfill siting, and that is not something that's very enviable.
Nobody wants one near them, and they're so critically important for all of us. You did touch on, I want to talk about real quickly, the Food Rescue Partnership. You're looking for ways to reduce food waste in the landfill.
Absolutely, and the Food Rescue Partnership is doing a great job of that. You know, they follow the outline of first buying the right amount of food and then getting it to hungry people, to hungry animals.
And that's what mostly restaurants, grocery stores, diners, food retail outlets.
Right. And if it's still unusable, then we're looking for ways that we can manage that, whether it's through anaerobic digestion or composting. Mm-hmm. Those are things we'll be looking at in a study that we're going to be doing here probably this summer.
You kind of throw things out, you want to forget about it. You're in charge of not letting us do that because you never really get rid of waste.
Absolutely, and our landfill right now is not going to be full until 2070, and we're hoping to make that even longer. So,
Kathy Morris, Director of the Scott County Waste Commission, thanks so much for joining us. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Take part in the survey, it could help us all. We also want to congratulate some talented writers. And all of them have a bright future ahead of them. That's because they're kindergartners, first, second, or third graders. And they took part in this year's WQPT student writing contest. Here are the winners in each grade level, first, second, and third place finishers. Their stories are being displayed at the Dear Wyman House this week, the Family Museum starting on the 4th, and the Figge Art Museum the week after that. We especially want to salute the first place winners. They include kindergartner Cameron Beyer of Moline, first grader Shiv Passy of Bettendorf, Lola Chesney Ilium from Bettendorf, and Davenport third grader Lachlan Gleason. The contest is sponsored by the Butterworth Center and the Dear Wyman House, the Family Museum, the Figge Art Museum, John Deere, the Midwest Writing Center, and of course, WQPT. And WQPT is also doing its part to support the military men and women in the cities who are serving our nation. We call it Embracing the Military. And on Monday, the Army Community Service Building will open its doors to spouses of active duty, retirees, and civilians for the twice monthly coffee break. It's a chance for spouses to network, socialize, and meet others on the island. And the next coffee break is Monday from 9:30 to 10:30 in Building 110. Oh, by the way, children are welcome. On the air, on the radio, on the web, and on your mobile device. Thanks for taking some time to join us. We talk about the issues on the cities.
Public Affairs programming on WQPT is brought to you by the Sing Group at Merrill Lynch, serving the wealth management needs of clients in the region for over 25 years.